Welcome to the Conspiracy Corner. I am Jim Harold and so glad to be with you. Well, today we are going to talk about the conspiracy theory. Now, many people would say this is the one that is the most out there. This is the wildest. This is the one that can't be true. And to be honest, I told our guest before we started, I am totally biased against this theory. Maybe he would think I'm brainwashed and we're all brainwashed, but I am very interested in hearing his insight. We're talking about Mark Sargent, and he believes that the earth is flat. Now, growing up on South Whidbey Island, Washington, Mark started his career playing computer games professionally in Boulder, Colorado. From there, he spent the next 20 years training people in proprietary software. In 2014, he looked into what he says no doubt is the most ridiculous conspiracy theory ever, called the Flat Earth Theory. But he was surprised. Through extensive research, he discovered that he felt it wasn't so laughable after all. Early in 2015, he released a series of YouTube videos titled Flat Earth Clues, which delves into the possibility of our human civilization actually being inside a Truman Show-like enclosed system and how it's been hidden from the public since 1956. Mark Sargent, thank you for joining us today.
Thank you very much, Jim, for having me. It is a pleasure to be here.
Okay. Now, again, I've said I personally believe that the Earth is a globe. So uh-huh. I'll just put my bias right out there. Yep. Sounds like you did, too. What changed that?
Again, I'd like to apologize to the listeners out there, because for a lot of people, this isn't your normal conspiracy yarn. You know, this is the one conspiracy that polarizes everybody. And so, and I like to throw that disclaimer, and I'm kind of working on different disclaimers out there depending on the audience, because everybody, almost everybody in the Flat Earth community starts out trying to debunk it. Like me, I didn't wake up one morning and say, Flat Earth, this is the greatest thing, the greatest idea ever. I'm going to write a book about it. I'm going to, you know, go on podcasts. I'm going to do all this stuff. That's not what we do. Everybody says the same thing, which is they hear about it. They laugh like everybody, and they say, well, this is ridiculous. It's stupid. There's no way this could be true. Therefore, I'm going to give just a little bit of time. I'm going to crush it into the ground, and then I'm going to move on and never, ever think about it again. And that's exactly what I did. I heard about it. I was a conspiracy guy for years, you know, kind of like you. You know, I delved into just about everything you could think of.
Right.
And this was the last book on the shelf. Never gave it any attention. You know, it's everyone knows the book is there. Everybody's heard about Flat Earth, which is unusual. You know, it's
sure.
Not like the other conspiracies. Everyone knows about it, but no one ever gives it any at the time of day. And so I saw this video. In fact, I was looking at something. I was really into Hollow Earth theory. And I was looking into Admiral Byrd and the Hollow Earth theory, and I just noticed that he actually had spent most of his life after 1926 down in Antarctica, you know, looking for something else, and he was kind of tied to the Flat Earth theory. And I was going, okay, that's kind of fun. And so I watched a video by a guy named Matt Boylan, an artist out, a photorealistic painter actually, out of Montreal, Canada, who said that at one point he made this little video, sober, mind you, because most of his videos he is not sober, where he said he had worked for NASA as a painter. And I go, and that he, during this party, and I'll rattle this off real quick because I know this is an intro question, but during this party where he was invited to a NASA party, I think out in the Hamptons on the East Coast of the United States, he was, you know, the power went out, there was a storm there. And they were down to wine and candles, and some guys were talking about this because, you know, they're swapping stories, nothing else to do. And they said, yeah, I heard a rumor that GPS doesn't work down in Antarctica. And so he says, well, Fred, you ought to send a team of your guys down there and see if you can validate that. And some other guy chimes in, some spooky guy. And he goes, well, if you send your team out that far, they're not coming back. And Matt, you know, is going, you know, Matt probably had a few glasses of wine. He goes, why wouldn't they be coming back? It's because GPS doesn't work down there. And Matt bit on that one. He goes, well, why doesn't it work? He goes, well, because it's flat. And Matt didn't get it. And he didn't get it for years. And the guy proceeded to take a piece of chalk and draw out on the tile floor what the map of the world actually looked like. And as he was drawing it, he was going all over the thermal dynamics and how everything works and the energy systems. And he goes, when he was done drawing this thing, he looked on the floor. It was a great intro for a movie, actually. And he saw basically the UN flag the UN flag logo, which is, if you want to know exactly what the flat earth looks like, you know, at least what, you know, until we can come up with a better map right now, it is the UN flag, where it's a circle, the, you know, like a dinner plate. You take a globe, you put your hand on the North Pole, you flatten it into the ground. And therefore, the North Pole becomes the center of a big dinner plate. And all the continents are splayed out on the outsides to where there's one continent, though, that doesn't look anything like we're told, which is Antarctica. And Antarctica isn't this continent, you know, this island continent, kind of like Australia. That's how it's described to us. It is instead an endless field of ice that surrounds the entire outside rim of this place. And that's where I started. I know it's kind of a long answer to your intro question, but that's how I started looking at this. And I tried to disprove it for 9 months. 9 months I worked on this sucker from summer of 2014 all the way to the beginning of 2015. Could not do it. The more I dug into it, the more threads I pulled on, the more everything started to fall apart, to where I finally said, all right, you know what? I'm going to go the other way. I'm going to put the question out to the internet. So I made a series of videos called Flat Earth Clues, and they're really rudimentary, you know, dummy's guide to flat earth stuff, and put it out to the internet. And I honestly thought a scientist was going to just shoot me down in 2 seconds. And instead, the opposite started happening, where Pete was resonating with a whole bunch of people. And I started getting phone calls, and then I started doing a bunch of interviews. And then a publisher out of London said, you got to write a book based on the clues. I said, okay. And then there's podcasts and all this other fun stuff. And I'm going, really? So no one's going to shoot this thing down? And then I'll end your intro with this, to where, you know, a Grammy-nominated rapper, B.O.B., comes out and makes an album series, and he calls out Neil deGrasse Tyson, you know, the world's most popular physicist, astrophysicist, and he says, look, I think the Earth is actually flat. And Neil deGrasse Tyson actually responds, goes on Comedy Central and says, oh, no, it's not, but he doesn't bring any really good evidence. And that was the early part of this year. And, you know, here we are coming, you know, sort of to a close in 2016, and this thing's just grown by leaps and bounds to where flat Earth, if you look on Google or YouTube or whatever, it's tracking actually faster and heavier than a lot of mainstream topics that have nothing to do with conspiracies. So that's where I am at this point.
So, okay. I think most people are going to say this. They're going to say, okay, what about the satellite pictures? What about the iconic pictures of the Earth from outer space? Yep. What about all of that where we clearly are seeing a globe? What about all that?
That's a great place to start, because that's where everyone that tried, remember, in fact, there's a t-shirt, I think, that's going to finally get made up by one of my, the guys in the community, David Weiss, who said, the t-shirt was, I became a flat earther because I tried to debunk flat earth. And that's the first place you're going to look. You're going to go straight to NASA. And that's where I started. And before I get into the pictures real quick, I'll throw out this question, which is, how do you know you're on a globe, right? You know, because everything else that we know about physics, we can test pretty much on the ground, more or less. You know, fire burns, water is wet, you drop something, you know, like a pen, it'll either fall to the ground. We know that sort of gravity. But when it comes to the shape of the world, this is something you're told. This is not something that you know by yourself. You know, nobody owns a spaceship. You know, we don't have Jetsons cars. We don't get to fly up there. We are told this. More specifically, we're told this by the United States government. So if you're outside of the United States living this, you know, you already probably have suspicions about the moon program. So when I started looking into the NASA program and Apollo and Gemini and Mercury and all those fun things, I started running into some weird stuff. And I'll relay a story I had to you, because this was in front of my face 15 years ago, and I didn't see it. That shows you how well the conditioning is. 15 years ago, 16 now, I was running a tech support department for this software company out in Boulder, Colorado. And I thought, oh, it'd be kind of cool if I put some iconic images on all our screens. And so I was looking for pictures of the Earth from space, right? I was pretty good at Boolean searches. I could type in all sorts of variations, right? And, you know, granted, the internet wasn't super rich like it is now, but it was okay, you know, back then. And I started typing this in and, you know, type into Google or whatever you want to type in at the time and click on images. And it's not like it is today. There literally was only one image. literally just rows and rows and rows of exactly the same image with in slightly different resolutions. And
Right.
it was the Apollo 17 picture from 1972. I was going, wait a minute, how is that even possible, right? And I immediately, you know, because again of our conditioning, I looked at this picture and I go, wait, it can't be. You know, I go, NASA can't have just one picture of the Earth from space. I go, NASA, you suck. And you know, I gave up after like a day or two, and then just finally switched to another image. But what I didn't know was, I wasn't wrong. There was literally only one picture, full sun, you know, disk picture taken of the Earth from space. We've all seen it from 1972, literally all the way up until summer of last year when we started asking a lot of questions, this community. And you know which one it is because it shows, you can look it up, Apollo 1972, blue marble. That's what it's called, the blue marble shot, the first blue marble. And it shows the bottom part of Africa and all of Antarctica, coincidentally. And I was going, wow, is that, you know, because you'd think the American space program would take a picture, a really nice glory shot at the United States, but they didn't. They took the bottom part of Africa and its heavy, heavy cloud cover and the rest of Australia. And we know that there was only one blue marble shot because summer of last year, the White House released the second shot. They were the ones that came out with it. Was said, you know, Obama did a press conference, says, you know, the second blue marble shot, you know, of the world. And I was going, whoa, you know, no one's going to address it. You know, Neil deGrasse Tyson tweeted it. NASA was the, you know, the ones, you know, in fact, if I'm not mistaken, the guy that wrote the press briefing that Obama read, that was Scott Kelly, the astronaut, if you believe in astronauts. And I'm going, this is so weird. So I basically I started going back and looking at a lot of pictures or so-called pictures of what was being taken from space, and there was literally only one shot. The rest of them were just composites, and by that I mean supposedly stitched together images. The first
Right.
iPhone, as a matter of fact, the artist from iPhone, the artist, if you remember, the very first iPhone had a picture of the globe on there. But that globe, he was interviewed a couple of years later, and he says, oh yeah, I had to create that from scratch. He had to basically work with a NASA consultant because there were no images to put on the iPhone for the first, you know, the first iconic iPhone shot. That was their background, the globe, of course. I was going, and the more I looked into this, the more images I looked into, the more I realized it's like it was just composite, 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 composite. And not only, I'll throw one more at you because I know you probably have a whole bunch of questions. Not only were there no pictures of Earth from space, there were no videos of the Earth from space. The closest that we got was the 1990 Galileo shot, which showed the Earth rotating on its axis from you know, for like a 24-hour period with no stars in the background for whatever reason, but the weather wasn't morphing at all. Earth rotated 24 hours and not a cloud moved out of place. And so now when you call when now when you call up NASA, and we had a guy pretend to be a Hollywood producer, it's on YouTube, it's pretty good. And he got, you know, the NASA trademark office and goes, yeah, you know, doing a movie like some stock footage of the Earth rotating on its axis from space. NASA says, we don't have it. Not only that, but and I put this in the clues, and I wasn't the one that discovered this, because again, the internet nerd community misses nothing. There is no exterior shot, no astronaut with a camera from any mission, starting from Mercury all the way through the ISS. There is no shot of an astronaut doing a 180-degree turn or better with a camera running. It just never happens. No astronaut never ever turned around with a camera. Oh yeah, you got still shots every once in a while, but nobody ever has any live video. There's no live video of any object with a camera running, mind you, unedited, leaving or returning into Earth orbit. There isn't even a shot of an astronaut opening up an airlock and, you know, with a camera following out. I mean, look, we have 4K cameras nowadays that are dirt cheap. They come free with a box of cereal. And these cameras aren't running anywhere. The JAXA program, and I know I'm rambling a little bit, so stop me.
That's all right. No,
The
there you go.
JAXA program, the Japanese space program, sent, it's, I don't know, was it 8 years ago now? Supposedly sent a probe around the moon with two different HD cameras. And they should have been, you know, just pointed down, taking a picture of the Sea of Tranquility. Looked at all the moon cars we left and the pods and everything. Took pictures of Jack. And while it was heading back to Earth, the camera just cuts out. He's like, what? There are. When you go and look, the short version of this is, when you go and look for pictures, trust me, I looked and everybody else has looked, and we've been going on this now for 19, 20 months. Nobody has there are no pictures of the Earth from space with the exception of what was released last year. And it's like, I'm sorry, you can't give me stuff last year. That's angry wife syndrome. Meaning, as people don't know what that means, is a husband comes home after 40 years or 20 years, we'll say 20 years of marriage, and the wife says, I'm leaving you. And he goes, well, why? And he goes, because these last 20 years have only brought me one bouquet of flowers. Very next day, what happens? He brings a bouquet of flowers and he says, well, our marriage is saved. And she goes, what are you talking about? The only reason you even brought me the flowers is because I mentioned them in the first place. That's
Right.
what NASA's been doing recently. They have been just flooding with us with as much stuff as they can, but it's all crap. It's all horrible. It's horrible resolution. They still cannot show any picture of the Earth rotating from space in any decent resolution, or they could do a geocentric orbit where they will show weather morphing, but then the Earth doesn't rotate. You can't get both at the same time. I'm going, why not? Why is this not possible? So sorry, I get kind of passionate.
Now,
I talk about this stuff.
I mean, what about Aristotle? What about the ancients who said that the earth was round? What about them?
Well, I'll flash forward a little bit. Yeah, of course, and again, I'm not saying that I'm more intelligent than Stephen Hawking or Albert Einstein or Neil deGrasse Tyson, even though I really don't consider him smart at all. I'm not saying that the community is more intelligent than these guys. I'm saying that the foundations were wrong to begin with. Just because you think. Here, let me put it a different way. The easiest one would to throw at people would be the sticks and shadow argument. And even a physicist will be the first ones to admit this. If you use the sticks and shadow argument, which would show it's like, well, this sh shows you can do this even in ancient times, that the sun has to be hundreds of thousands of miles wide and 93 million miles away. Well, yeah, unless the perspective is different, unless it's just a few thousand miles away. And it's very, very small by comparison. The same thing works. The same sticks and shadows argument works. Well, let me throw it a different way at you, because this will kind of get where everyone's head is at, especially anyone listening right now. It was like, how do you know you are where you think you are? George Orwell, you know him from the book
Of course.
1984. In 1946, he wrote an article specifically addressing this, and he was kind of he wasn't a big flat earth guy, but he was kind of addressing how science convinces people of things just by saying, well, it's obvious, it's obvious. You repeat that enough, as our calculations say this, then people are just going to buy it, and generation after generation, then it just gets passed down, and we all assume this. So he said, he goes, it's interesting. In fact, I wonder if I have the quote in front of me. Hang on one second. Short description. Yeah, okay. I'll read this real quick. This is from 1946, December specifically. He goes, most people, if asked to prove that the Earth is round, would not even bother to produce the rather weak arguments I've outlined above, which you talked about earlier. They would start off by saying that everyone knows the Earth to be round, and if
Right.
pressed further, would become angry. So here's the interesting part about that. That was 1946, right? NASA wasn't even founded until 1958. This was just after World War II. There was rocket technology was in its infancy, unless you count Germany, which is a whole other story. So how did everybody know the Earth was round back in 1946? It was because you were told it was round. You were shown images. The greatest brainwashing trick we ever pulled off was putting a globe in a classroom of kindergarten. I mean, the CIA would pay good money for this sort of stuff, where you just put a globe in a classroom and that's it. 12 years later, if you make it through high school, you never have a doubt in your mind because you've been looking at this globe pretty much every day. You don't even have to really explain it to them. Just let them play with it. And that's it. The question is, you're just looking at a model. What if they were wrong? And that's basically the question I put out there through all this different stuff. What if they were wrong? What if the United States and the Soviet Union in 1956 actually figured it out? What if they had some of the old maps, Indiana Jones style, went down there, looked for it for 30 years, which was Admiral Byrd, which I don't know if we'll have time for, and they found out, it's like, holy crap, there is an edge. Then what do you do? Do you tell the public? Do you actually tell the public that science, who has been, building this huge case against religion, and I'm not doing a pro or con religion here. I'm not trying to play sides, but if science had been, building up this case for hundreds of years and they were wrong, Would you tell anybody? And if you think, well, of course I would. I would really watch the end of the first Indiana Jones movie, the whole Ark of the Covenant thing. What happened at the end? The whole movie was about getting the Ark of the Covenant. Who got it in the end? The Americans did. And the last 60 seconds, which I still think is the most telling of the whole movie, what do? They put it in a crate, they put it in a warehouse, and no one ever, ever, ever gets to see it, ever. Because it goes against science. Anything that goes against science will be erased, it will be buried. Unless somebody else that's non-scientific finds it, and really, what's the chance that that's going to happen? So that's what I think happened. I think they figured it out. I think Admiral Byrd figured it out during one of his flight missions in 1956 during Operation Deep Freeze, and then they had to contact the Soviet Union, and they said, "All right, we got to whatever it takes. We got to hold on to this because civilization as we know it could descend into chaos if that happened." Because once you figure out that you're in an enclosure, because this is the big question, which you may ask me eventually anyway, which is why? Why would you hide it? Why would you
Yeah,
care?
that's the question because okay, I mean if it were, I mean obviously this belief that the Earth is round has
Yes.
gone way back, and you talk about NASA and things like that, but to your own point, NASA being founded what in 58, they found this out in 56, so why would there be this focus on holding it back? I mean,
Why
what would be the yeah, what
it'd
would be
be
the reason?
the big question, the big here's the reason. Power is fickle, meaning, but it has to be absolute, meaning same sort of thing. And you probably thought of this before, which is why, we all know there's UFOs flying around, and they have been around a long time before Roswell and before the Americans. So the American government cannot admit, we'll use the Air Force specifically, they can't admit that there are UFOs flying around. Because if you don't rule the skies, if there are things up there that are faster than you, that are
Right.
better, the better your tech, then your authority really gets undermined. You can't be the ultimate authority if you're not the ultimate authority. So if all of a sudden, and here's where I'm getting to, and I talked about this in the clues, which is if all of a sudden it is realized that there is somebody higher than governments and secret societies and whatever. What I'm saying is, because if it is a flat world, if it is an, and I don't even use flat earth as much as I say enclosed world, hence the website enclosedworld.com. I was always going with that. So sort of like the Truman Show, the movie with Jim Carrey from 1998. This is basically a giant version of that. If it was built like that, if it was created like that, then there is a creator. I'm not going to define God here. I'm saying, okay, it could be the divine, could be an advanced civilization that was sort of like the divine. I mean, we're just kind of splitting hairs there. So if that's the case, what sort of authority does anybody inside here really have? Religion would have a massive uptick, and people, basically what I'm saying is, look, the governments would have a hard time controlling people because a lot of people say, look, you're not the big fish in this pond. Somebody built this place and you're just living here. So your ability to dictate to us what we do and think and everything, it would be undermined, and they don't want to risk it. They've got to figure out a way to spin it to their advantage if that's all possible. So at the time, again, it was an easy decision to make for them. So easy, because they sat down. It's like, especially with the religious angle, because religion, there would be way too much of a temptation for religion to just attack science, in revenge fashion. It's like, look, you guys have been here. Here's another one. Imagine this, religion going to science, like, yeah, you were wrong about the shape of the earth. So what else are you wrong about?
Right.
You wrong about evolution? You wrong about the Big Bang? And then you got the flip side, and people are saying, hey, religion was right about this. The firmament and God's footstool and all this other fun, the earth doesn't move and all those how countless passages in the Bible hinting at this. That it's like, well, religion was right about this. What else are you right about? And oh, the paradigm shift. Again, people in seats of power just shudder, I think, at the thought. So they thought, all right, we'll just hold on to this for as long as we can, and 60 years later, it looks like it's falling apart.
So the Earth is, let's say that you're right that it's this enclosed world, and I want to talk about exactly what that means in a bit. But what does that mean for the stars, for the other planets, for the moon? I mean, is that all just a facade too?
Well, it is, but it's not, because some people were saying, and unfortunately, I don't know your take on this. Some people emailed me and said, well, aren't you killing astrology? Not astronomy, but astrology. And I said, that's how I want to lead with this, which is no, I'm not at all. I'm not saying that the stars aren't there. I'm not saying the moon, the sun, and all that stuff isn't there. What I'm saying is they are much, much smaller and much more intimate, and they are exclusive to your system. And what I'm basically saying is, I know this kind of dates me. I may sound younger, but I'm actually not. Is that it is really a glorified Truman Show planetarium. So when you look up in the sky, when you go into a planetarium, because some people say, well, no, you know what? In fact, I got an argument with a guy a couple of months ago. It's like, no, look, I'm an amateur astronomer. I've looked up at a telescope. I've seen the moons of Jupiter. I'm going, and so what? I go, we've got 4K televisions right now, which produce resolution that's so good that we could probably simulate this to a, you know, on a smaller scale. I go, let's say you go to a planetarium. You bring a pair of binoculars with you. You're in there, your eyes adjust, everything's fine. You're looking at Jupiter. Now you're looking at it with a pair of binoculars. The question is, did the binoculars make Jupiter inside that building look more or less real? It's a rhetorical question. Doesn't matter because you're in a planetarium. The thing I'm proposing is, okay, who's to say that when you walk outside of that, you're not in just a bigger one? That's really what we're saying here. And it's like, well, no, it's too big. You know, you can't fool everybody. Going, you don't have to fool everybody. If it's that big, and again, I talk about it in the clues. Once you, the Truman Show was a fantastic concept and very, very real, you know, realistic, I should say. And that is, you could fool somebody if they were born into the system. If you expanded and made that Truman Show 100 miles wide, 1,000 miles wide, 10,000 miles wide, I'm not saying we built it. I'm saying somebody way, more intelligent and more advanced with tech built it. If you built it that far, it becomes much, much easier because then running into the edge becomes much, much tougher. You know, you just create negative reinforcements like, oh, I don't know, chilling, you know, reducing the temperatures on the outside rim to where icebergs form, then creating a continent, you know, like Antarctica, which is unique compared to any other landmass we have. A lot of people know it's like, look, even when you get to the coastline, it's like 150, 200 feet straight up, made out of solid ice. And then the other part that most people don't know is it slopes up almost immediately to like 2 miles high. It's a plateau with no indigenous animal life, no plant life, no ancient ruins. There's no reason to be there. So if you go there, you got to bring your own supplies. How long, you know, can you last on there? It just screams, go away. And it's, I forgot where I was going with this. I went off
Well,
the
we were talking
details.
about the planets and
Oh
the
yeah, I'm
stars,
sorry. The
right?
plants and the stars. So the plants and stars. It is the plants and the stars are a giant. You know what? What are they on the inside of a planetarium? They're just a giant projection system. Now, do I think it's being projected from the ground like a planetarium? No. I think it's completely up in the firmament. I'll throw a few biblical references out here and there where they said the stars were fixed inside or, you know, on the firmament itself. Which I gotta also mention one more thing. Again, you want to have some fun little, you know, X-Files music moments. Look up Wernher von Braun, you know, the founder of NASA, you know, the ex-Nazi
Sure.
German science. Look up his headstone. You think that the guy like that, the founder of NASA, would have this giant stone monolith with him reaching up to the sky with a big rocket behind him? No, it's just him. Yuri was born, Yuri died, and then one little thing, it says Psalms 19:1. I had to look it up. I didn't know, you know what it was. Psalms 19:1, and the firmament shows his handiwork. Why in the world would that would you know the when you talk about the jokes about not being a rocket scientist, he is the rocket scientist. Why is he talking about the firmament? Why is he reaching beyond the grave and saying that you know he knows a secret that nobody else knows? I think so. So anyway, yeah, it's a bunch of lights, no different than the planetarium, with the exception of the moon and the sun, I think are physical objects, but they are no different than a mobile spinning in, above a child's crib. So the moon and the sun, same roughly the same size, and the moon is self-illuminated on top of it, because people are, you know, you want to look up some also some fun stuff. Look up moon temperatures. Meaning, the moon generates a cold light, and people, the first reaction from everybody listening will be like, no, we all know that it's colder at night. It's like, no. The moon actually cools things down. So when we figured this out, where again, I'm not going to take credit for it, where you take everyone knows, like if you're in sunlight, it's colder in the shade, right? So if it's 100 degrees in the
Right.
sun, it's 90 degrees in the shade. You go to the moonlight, like especially in a full moon, especially if it's high in the sky. You go in and let's say, well, we'll use Fahrenheit instead of Celsius. I'm sorry to anybody else that's not Celsius. Let's say it's 50 degrees in the moonlight, right? When you go to the moon shade, well, because it's reflecting the sun's rays, it should be a little bit cooler, right? No, it's actually warmer. We've seen swings up to 13 degrees. So by what I'm saying is it may be 50 degrees in the moonlight, but it's 60 degrees in the moon shade, and it shouldn't be. That goes against everything we know about physics and everything we've been told about the relationship to the moon, which does make sense because the moon is blindingly white when it's a full moon. But yet all those moon photos that we saw from Apollo were all this super dull gray color. There was no glow anywhere. And I was one, I will take credit for this though. I said, okay, here's a fun, because I remember reading this months ago and about the moonlight and the temperature. I go, what happens, if you take, we all know if you take a magnifying glass of the sun and you put it on a piece of paper, it'll, you can burn ants and burn paper, right? What happens
Right.
if you magnify moonlight? Does it get warmer or does it get colder? And I'll be darned if it doesn't get colder. I've seen some great experiments. It's like if you magnify moonlight, not only is the moonlight cold, but magnifying cold moonlight is actually colder, which means, and you're thinking, well, I've never even heard of this before. And it means it is, we can simulate this now in labs. It's called a cool laser. Everybody thinks that lasers are hot, but we can actually generate something called a cool laser, which can actually cool things with light. And it's not something we sell in civilian markets because why would you ever do that? But that's actually what's happening with the moon. It is amazing to see. And so yeah, whatever's going on with the moon, yeah, I'm saying that the moon is its own independent object. It is not reflecting the sun rays. The sun is its own object. Also, about the same size, which is, again, coincidentally, why the moon fits so perfectly in front of the sun during an eclipse. We always thought it was a coincidence that even though it was 400 miles, 400 times farther away, that it was also exactly 400 times less diameter, which is why it fit. And the other weird thing about the moon, which everyone thinks, oh, it's just a coincidence, is that we never see the other side of it. It's constantly perfectly rotating, so we only see one side of the moon, exactly one side. It's not like we have like a quarter of a degree every 5 years or half a degree here and there. It's always the same side. There are no coincidences when it comes to this system. It was deliberately built, but I think it was deliberately built to be detected. And I think we were naturally supposed to figure this thing out maybe as late as the 1970s, but the government figured it out first, and they have been doing spending a heck of a lot of money trying to keep it a secret since then.
I have a question about the stars. Now, you said the stars is a planetarium, kind of like what we're seeing is like a planetarium, but that would almost make it seem that maybe I'm missing something on the timeline here. It was discovered at around 56. The collective powers decided, it sounds like the US and the Soviet Union, hey, we got to keep this under wraps. Okay. Well, stars were seen before 1956. So the planetarium would almost seem to be part of the cover up. So I'm a little confused on the timing here of the planetarium aspect and the conspiracy to cover up where that plays in.
No, it's okay. The this place, what I do believe is that around 500 years ago, that whoever built this place realized that, and I talked about this in the clues. 500 years ago, the people that built this realized, and they probably knew this a long time ago, that sooner or later technology was going to be invented, whether it be optical or radar, or more specifically, the one, most important one is the internal combustion engine, that we were going to find the edge. Because remember, before 500 years ago, that was more or less the common belief. And I, you can talk about the Greeks and the Babylonians and whatever. And yes, there were certain groups that said, well, no, it could be a globe. Most of your other, your major religions, Hinduism, Judaism, Buddhism, Islam, and Christianity, they believed that it was a, a flat structure. So the thing is, once people figure it out, if people figured out that we were an enclosed system, the more advanced we got, it would be the biggest thought on our minds. That's all we care about. Human beings are very, very different from all animal life in that a wildlife reserve, if you make a wildlife reserve big enough, most animals don't care. People, though, would absolutely care. You could make a wildlife reserve 1,000 miles square. All people, all human beings would do is just be knocking on the fence constantly, going, "What? Why is this fence here? Who built the fence? Why are we in here?" And so on and so on. So when it came to, we're talking about the conspiracy, we're talking about two different things. There, the conspiracy to create the globe model was created hundreds of years ago by whoever helped build this place. There were certain scientists that got involved in here, and then the church ended up backing it. But only after 1956 did mankind really, really get involved. Because before that, we didn't have the technology to do anything. For example, let's say you had an old map. And I'm sure that secret society is talking, the Illuminati, the Bilderbergs, the Rothschilds, whoever. I'm sure older groups had the maps, but until you had the technology to find it yourself, what did you really know? So you say you're the king of France in 1500, right? And you say you had a map of the flat earth. So what? What are you going to do? You got wooden ships and horses. You're not going to be able to go anywhere. No coincidence. Once the internal combustion engine came out and you could make planes, that's exactly, we started exploring more and more. And so Admiral Byrd did the North Pole in 1926. And then from 1928 all the way until 1956, he was looking for something down in Antarctica. Flying constantly. That's all the man did. He just flew these missions, government backed. And I think they were looking for it. I think they gave up in 1954. Again, you want to watch a wonderful little program. We were so lucky to get it. Watch the Longines. Pronounced that wrong. Longines chronoscope from 1954, where he goes on national television and says that Antarctica is made out of money, and that there's coal, there's uranium, there's oil, and that people are going to be fighting down there, and we're going to be down there forever. And yet 2 years later, during Operation Deep Freeze, something happens, and whatever they found spooked everybody, and unilaterally all the countries that were down there ran off the ice like their life depended on it. I mean, the Soviet Union, Great Britain, Chile, Argentina, New Zealand, Australia, and they started building what's known as the Antarctic Treaty, which is the only treaty in the world ever to be signed unilaterally and kept, where no corporation in the world can do any work down in Antarctica ever. But most people don't know that. It's like, what do you mean ever? I mean ever. If you all of a sudden created a new country, tomorrow called, Jim Harold Country,
right?
And became an economic power, you would have this paper put in front of you. And it's like, what is it? Well, it means you got to sign this. It's part of the Antarctic Treaty. It means you can't go to Antarctica. It's like, what are you talking about? I've got an oil company. We know there's oil down there. What if we bribed you? What if we gave you, a couple million dollars? Nope. Not only can you not go down there, you can't even talk about going down there. You can't run full page ads in newspapers. You can't contact your buddy at Newsweek or Time magazine and say how great it would be for my company to go down there. Nobody gets to go down there. The treaty isn't even up for debate until 2041. And now, in fact, this year, again, just coincidentally, just recently, they just put a whole nother layer in place to where the waters off of it are now off limits to even fishing boats. And that treaty is set in stone for the next 35 years. They're blaming like the Chilean sea bass. What in the heck are you talking about? The United States military has the greatest presence down there. And what treaty have you ever heard of where everybody falls in line? Russia's not going to sneak in there. China's not going to sneak in there. Nobody gets to go there. It's like, people say, well, no, I'm looking this up online as you're talking right now. I can take a trip there. I'm like, yeah, you can. You can pay about 15 grand and you can go on the Outer Peninsula and have your picture taken with penguins. You do not get to go unmonitored, just traipsing around the ice. They will not let you do it. You have to apply in advance and they will know where you are at all times. You will not be able to go very far, though. Not that it matters, because I'm sure the outer edge is probably several thousand miles off the coastline. But anyway, sorry, I'm off in the weeds again.
No, I mean, it's fascinating. Now, talk to us about the enclosed world.
Sure.
And explain that I'm looking at a picture on your site. Kind of give us, what you think Earth looks like, it's tough to do, it's an audio show, but kind of give us a feel of how you think physically, the Earth actually looks like, and talk about this dome, because that's fascinating to me as well.
Sure. I believe that, it's weird. Again, I don't want to preach any one religion here, because I do respect all of them. But I do believe that religion had it right. And I'll use Christianity as a reference point here. Because if you believe the first book of the Bible, Genesis, they talk about the firmament, which was a barrier that separated the waters above and the waters below. And that basically this world was created sort of like a snow globe in a certain way. And it could be more like a shallow sports stadium. I don't think it's arc heavy arcing like a like a snow globe, but that we are on, if you took a dinner plate and, you know, put a cake pan on top of it, that's really what we're looking at here, that we were created at, it's basically an enclosed system. What the barrier is made out of, boy, take your pick there. You know, there's a whole bunch of science fiction movies you could reference. Is it a heavy element? Is it a heavy metal? Is it heavy water? Is it a electromagnetic force field? Is it a unified field? Is it frequency based? We don't know. But it surrounds the entire thing, and it is high enough that we don't have to worry about commercial air traffic. But space programs, yes, we do have to worry about it, which is why the space program starting off and with the United States and Russia. Late 1950s, they militarized the sky, and any other space program after that had to blueprint off of us, and they were let in at the know at the highest levels. So when people say, you know, people come back and say, well, you know, you're saying that everybody in NASA know this? I'm going, no, almost nobody in NASA knows this. I've known NASA people that have worked their entire lives, all the wrench turners, everybody on the ground, nobody knows anything. The telemetry guys, they may know something, but if you compartmentalize a secret well enough, you can keep it. I will use the Manhattan Project, you know, the whole atomic weapons thing. And that was like hundreds of thousands of people were working on atomic weapons. Everyone kind of knew what they were doing, but nobody talked about it. But at the highest levels, they were the ones that knew the ultimate secret. Anyway, so the firmament is a dome-like structure which surrounds the entire thing. Again, if you take a salad bowl, put it on top of, you know, a flat surface, and there is quite a bit of distance, I think, between the outer edge of where we are, where Antarctica starts, and where this dome slash enclosed world begins. I think it's at least several thousand miles wide. If it wasn't, you know, it's not definitely just not off the coastline, because Admiral Byrd in his planes didn't find it for 30 years. So, and with refueling stations, you know, granted they were prop planes, they didn't go that fast, but even at a couple hundred miles an hour, it took him a long time to figure out what it was. And once they figured out what it was, and you're thinking, well, what's it sort of shaped like? I think they were trying to map that out in the 1950s, because the atomic weapons program really took a strange turn. You know, it started in 1945, but it took a strange turn right after Operation Deep Freeze, where the United States and Russia, for whatever reason, immediately started firing nuclear-tipped weapons straight up, and they did it for 4 years, starting from, you know, 1958 all the way to the end of 1962. And some of those first shots were extremely heavy duty, and we're talking megaton shots, you know, 2 and 3 megatons. Which are, you know, Hiroshima and Nagasaki were 20 kilotons. These things were big hits. And they weren't, I think they were initially trying to bust through it, trying to see if they could breach it. And after that, they just trying to map the sky, because you need to know kind of the curve and distances. Because if you are going to, you know, at least simulate a space program, you don't want to crash too many rockets. So that's why, again, you want to watch some interesting footage, look at the time-lapse photos or pictures of any rocket that ever goes up from any space program. They arc over and almost go horizontal very quickly. And so I think it's shallow. I think it's like a sports stadium in terms of height, but it's still, you know, high enough, you know, it's way above commercial air traffic. You know, commercial planes cap out at about 10 miles. That's about 50,000 feet or more. And spy planes maybe twice that. So it's way up there. But again, anything above that is controlled by the military. And no coincidence there. They control access. They control the outer markers. Again, one more thing. I don't believe in coincidences. That NASA was formed in 1958. The Van Allen radiation belts, if you ever heard of those, they were
Oh,
announced
yes.
in 1959 by Van Allen, a NASA employee, that said that there's these massive bands of radiation that nobody should ever go through, and they're super deadly to us. And yet, only a few years later, Kennedy goes, "Oh yeah, we're totally going to go to the moon and go through those." And then Van Allen had to recant and say that, "Oh yeah, well, you can go through them if you go real fast." It's like, really? Because they're 60,000 miles thick, supposedly, according to you. So even if our best stuff at then was only doing about 16, 17,000 miles an hour, that's hours going through. What shield are you using? Using gold or lead? Because those are the only two metals that can block radiation right now. They didn't never said what they used. But my point is that 1959, Van Allen announced the radiation belts, and also in 1959, what happened? The Antarctic Treaty was formed. So in the same year, they said, "Oh yeah, The upper ceiling, nobody should ever go there, which basically dissuaded anybody from, you know, private sector from doing a space program. And then at the same time, they also said, oh yeah, Antarctica is locked down too. But they did that real, real quiet. So, and there was so, don't discount what those two moves were. Those were huge moves because they were exactly, if I had to try to hide the world, that's what I'd do. I'd say, I'd try to, you know, put big warning signs. Do not go here, which means don't go up. Do not go out. You know, warning signs out there. Just stay inside your wheelhouse. Everything will be fine. Let us handle the rest.
So here's a question for you. What about Elon Musk and people talking about going to Mars and all these different things? What about all of that?
Oh, God, those guys. Unfortunately, you know, there were, and again, the Van Allen radiation belts were to dissuade the private sector, the private subcontractors back in the day. You know, there were companies way before Elon Musk and Virgin Galactic and Interorbital, which we'll get to hopefully, which, like, you know, there were companies way, way bigger and way more capable of doing their own things. You know, the contractors for NASA, like Boeing, like Lockheed Martin, like General Dynamics, you know, these were big, big names, you know, heavy, heavy hitters. And they didn't do anything for years and years and years. When it comes to Elon Musk and Virgin Galactic and anything, and I'm not just going to pick on them. I'm going to pick on any space story you've ever heard, because now you're hearing space stories pretty much every day. The Orion program, they're all designed to do one thing. And that is, it doesn't matter if you believe or even pay attention to whatever the story is. So it's like, oh yeah, here's a new picture of Pluto. Or here is a weird hexagram thing on the top of Saturn, or a face on Mars, or, oh, look, we found another super Earth, right? All those stories have nothing to do with each other. It's the subtext. It's the subliminal message that's underneath. And that is, doesn't matter if you believe it, you're thinking about it from a globe. All they care about is like, oh yeah, I'm thinking about the face on Mars because I'm on a globe. So a little interesting on Saturn because I'm on a globe, so on and so on. All it is reinforcement. I can tell you right now, and because with 100% accuracy, that the Orion program is never, ever, ever going to happen, because you can't fake it anymore. The internet detection ability has gotten far, far too microscopic. There's websites out there called moviemistakes.com. where nerds in the middle of the night will go through a freaking Blu-ray and just go frame by frame, and if a coffee cup moves from one side of the room to the other without the actor moving it, they're going to call you out on it. It's the reason we haven't gone back to the moon, and the Orion program is doomed because of it. Because you can't. It's not like the movie Capricorn 1 from the late 70s, where, you know, you could get away with things because you can't. There was no internet back then. You couldn't review it. Nowadays, you absolutely can review it. If you make one production mistake, you're screwed. We've been finding it in all sorts of stuff. All the NASA footage, all the ISS footage, all the Apollo footage. We've been finding all the mistakes that have ever been done. Orion, Elon Musk. Oh yeah, Elon coming out and saying that, oh yeah, we're going to colonize Mars. That has nothing to do with the fact that he had a rocket blow up just a week earlier and he was worried about his stock price plummeting. So he comes out and says, oh yeah, we can totally colonize Mars. No, you can't. I'll use the, if you think I'm kidding here, go and look up, because it's on the internet right now. I don't know why NASA released this. It's a video on NASA.gov called Orion Trial by Fire. You can just Google it. It'll take you to NASA.gov, where NASA's talking about its, you know, Orion program. This was done end of 2014, right? It's not too long ago. And they were saying that the Van Allen radiation belts, they still haven't figured out how to get through them. What are you talking about? It's 2014. You supposedly took 7 round trips with people, you know, the Apollo program. Nobody died from radiation poisoning. Nobody got sick. Nobody got cancer. You got through them. So why can't you get through them now? Well, I don't know why, who made that video and why it's such a huge mistake. But if they're making that sort of mistake now, they're just kicking the can down the road. Elon's not sending anybody anywhere. Virgin Galactic, no, it's never, ever going to happen. Orion, they're just going to keep, it's kind of going to be like the hydrogen fuel cell car. You're going to talk, it's like, oh yeah, we're going to go to Orion in 10 years. We're going to go, and then 10 years from now, oh yeah, another 10 years we're going to Orion. They're just going to keep kicking that down the road. No one's going anywhere because the internet hive mind is too good at spotting the mistakes. So there you go.
Well,
Still there?
It's one. Yeah, I'm here. Hold on a second. I was having some kind of technical issue.
Oh, no
count
worries.
that down. I'll edit that out. Okay, 5, 4, 3, 2. Well, it is a fascinating topic. I mean, we could go on and on and on because I think that it's a very rich area to explore for yourself, make your own decision. I still believe the Earth is round, but I have to admit, you have made me think a few times during our interview, and I very much appreciate that. Obviously, you have a book out, you have the videos, you have websites. Where can people go to learn more about the idea that we're living on a flat Earth?
The easiest way, and I could rattle off the websites and all the other crap, but look, the easiest way to find it right now is just to type in, you can do it one of two ways. You can go to any search engine, Google or Dogpile or whatever, and type in Flat Earth Clues, and you will find it. Or if you want to have some fun, you don't really, you know, I don't really care if you look at my stuff because I'm just trying to get the word out. Go to YouTube and just type in Flat Earth and look at just pages and pages and pages. I mean, the amount of content that has come out in this in the last year especially is just crazy. I mean, we're tracking better than just about any mainstream thing that's out there right now that's happened in the last 5, 10 years. It's crazy. So yeah, look up Flat Earth Clues if you want to find it, and you'll find all the references. I'm not going to pawn off websites on you, but you'll find the audiobook and the main book and the YouTube site. The YouTube website is kind of fun. I've got a whole ton of videos out there, but again, don't look at just my stuff and don't believe anything I'm telling you here, right? Do your own research, ask your own questions. I'm not going to try to convince you during a 1 hour show. You got to, you know, make the decision for yourself. Just look inside Pandora's box. Don't make fun of the box from outside and say it's a stupid box. Look, peek inside for just a minute. See what you find.
Well, thank you so much for taking time to actually give us a peek inside that box as you see it, Mark Sargent. It's been a fascinating hour, and we appreciate your time.
Hey, thank you very much for having me.
And thank you for tuning in to Conspiracy Corner. Is the Earth flat? Decide for yourself. That's what we do here. I thank you so much for joining us, and I'm guessing Mark would agree. Next time you're going around the corner, be careful, because there just might be a conspiracy. We'll talk to you next time. Have a great week, everybody. I hope that was okay.
That was great. Thank you.
Yeah, I'm very much about letting the guest make their case, even if it's something I'm not.
Oh, it's
and
okay.
I'm gonna definitely look into it more. I'm interested. You've got my interest, so.
It's a weird one, man. I wasn't kidding when I said that I didn't want to do this. This is a stupid topic, but it just won't go away, and it just keeps getting weirder and bigger and. I've had a lot of fun with it, and people keep saying, let's just keep going down this road. So why not?
Sounds good. Thanks so much. I really appreciate it.
All right. Have a good day. Okay.
All right. You too. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.